They've been doing that since 2009?
Yes, ma'am.
So when they back up the email system, why are they doing that?
Why do we back it up?
Yeah.
Mostly because of virus protection, but we're required some limited backups for FOIA purposes.
Okay. So that they're available if someone FOIAs an email?
Yes, in fact, that's the only person in our district that, once we get the request from, I believe, Kelly Allen's office, that has access to that FOIA, has access to that material, that can actually go in and FOIA.
So just on an off note, how long would it take us if we got a FOIA to access an email? Because if it's backed up.
Well, and I think I would like to clarify, because I think I know where you're going with that.
You do?
Yes, I do. There was actually a change in how we stored emails. You know, we previously.
So this person's changed how we stored them?
What was.
For this time?
Right. How we store emails has changed. We didn't used to keep them accessible, and then we had that one incident where we had to hire an individual and to extract some emails, and from that time we changed the process. So yeah, we didn't have the level of backup that was desired, and at the time it was discussed that when we went to our new system, we had made that decision, but that was no longer a good decision. And so, we ran across an email that we couldn't get without spending some money on it. So from that point forward, we changed how we captured and collected emails, and now our ability to extract emails is much harder than it used to be.
So we were paying someone all along to back up the email system, but yet we weren't able to access it. That was when we had an incident where I requested some emails and was told that we would have to pay a lot of money to get them because they weren't accessible.
Mm-hmm.
So why are we paying them?
Are they accessible?
I have a question.
All right. Yes. Yeah.
Excuse me.
Please.
I'm reading this, and is it $72,000 a year, or is it $72,000 for 3 years?
$72,000 a year. It's a 3-year
contract. A year, and it's a 3-year contract.
Yes.
Okay, so what's the real clear with there?
All right.
So we're paying $72,000 a year. Despite the fact that we just added 3 technology positions, and yet we're getting rid of parapros that are in front of kids?
All right, we have a motion in front of us. I understand
that's
a rhetorical question.
Land.
No, that's a rhetorical question. There's no answer to that question. Thank you very much.
The answer is, it's not common sense.
We have a motion in front of us.
They're lacking it.
And we have a motion supported by Board Member Hoover, made by Board Member Hoover, supported by Board Member.
The answer is that our priorities are not in check. Our priorities do not seem to be the kids here.
I know you have opinions, thank you.
Yes, I do.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Okay, roll call, please.
Mr. Hoover?
Yes.
Mrs. McClatcher?
Yes.
Mrs. Sergio?
No.
Mrs. Hornberger?
No.
Mrs. Hilton?
No.
Mrs. Ross, yes. Mr. Huebler?
Yes. Motion carries, thank you. Next is also business office, please.
Yes, the second item tonight is K2, which is a recommendation to approve the 2016 summer tax collection rates. It was at the December meeting. We got authorization to request, to forge ahead, I should say, in the summer tax collection. We have 4 townships that process that on our behalf. Chesterfield, Clinton, Harrison, and McComb Township. Clinton Township, Harrison Township, and Macomb Townships, the amount that is included in the proposed rate also includes, they do collect from Macomb Community College as well as the Macomb Intermediate School District, but we do get reimbursed for that. So in the middle of the page, the 2016 proposed rates for Chesterfield Township is $1.14. You'll see that is an increase over the 15 rate, which was 67 cents. That is the main reason for that is one, postage has gone up, but the biggest reason is that Chesterfield Township used to charge their taxpayers, citizens, a processing fee. They've eliminated that fee and we're absorbing that cost. Clinton Township is $1.75, their rate went up 2 cents. Harrison Township rate went up 3 cents to $2.53, and McComb Township rate stayed the same at $1.75. Administration recommends the board motion to approve and authorize administration to execute collection of the 2016 summer taxes by local municipalities.
Is there a motion for the board to approve and authorize administration to execute collection of 2016 summer taxes by local municipalities under page 2?
I'll make the motion.
Is there a support?
Support.
I have a motion and support. Any discussion on the motion?
Yes, I have a question. Can you explain to me what the amount including agency costs is?
Yes, that is the amount in that right column you see. That is the amount that we will get reimbursed. We'll go ahead and we'll invoice the Macomb Community College and the ISD because they're collecting on their behalf. So we absorb the original cost from those three townships. We pay the townships. Then once that's all collected, then we will bill those two entities and we get our money back.
So Clinton Township here is 32 cents.
Correct.
So we would get 32 cents per parcel back from Clinton.
Correct. And then Harrison is $1.06.
Why is Harrison Township so much higher than Clinton and Macomb in agency costs?
Well, that's a good question. I cannot answer that, but if you just look at, they charge us more to do the collection to begin with, so I would imagine then the cost that travels through is going to be higher than what the other ones are.
If I understand, we could ask the MISD to hold those tariffs back, is that right?
We could, and we could travel down that road, but the ISD would prefer not to go into the tax collection business.
So, the Harrison Township, when they are charging us that, we're not paying over there because actually they're collecting taxes, like Rochelle said, for both the ISD and the community college at the same time. But if you recall, we've been kind of nasty to the Harrison Township people for the last few years, and we've kind of been sticky about it. So we're kind of getting our just.
They always have.
I don't know why.
They always
Well, actually, they didn't come in higher than anybody else until we decided to kind of.
No, that's not true.
Okay, so we're going to have to agree to disagree.
Okay.
Mrs. Scott, do you know what's the limit? What's the highest amount they can charge us?
Oh, I know there's some.
There's an upper limit for first.
There is an upper limit. I do not know that.
$7.50.
That's the limit. You know, it's always bothered me being a resident of Harrison Township. This comes up every year and I see this number. It does bother me. Harrison Township used to send us the most students because they were the people who had the block, even though a smaller township population was higher. That is no longer the case. Chesterfield has more students depending on schools right now than Harrison Township. They want $1.14. Harrison Township was $2.53. It's always bothered me, and I live in that township, and I just don't understand it. I've asked this question now for 12 years, Mary, and it always comes in higher.
All right, okay, on page 2, we have a motion by Board Member Serville, support by Board Member Ross. All in favor?
I'd like a roll call.
Roll call.
Okay. Mrs. Sturdivant?
Yes.
Mrs. Ross? Yes. Mrs. Hornberger?
Yes.
Mrs. McClatcher?
No.
Mr. Hoover?
No.
Mrs. Hilton?
Yes.
And Mr. Hubler?
Yes.
Aye, Mr.
Motion carries. Thank you. On to the human resources office. Nonetheless, we have, again, I appreciate the recommendation from the board and the efforts of staff to basically index the changes to policy. We have, we have a second group of policy updates, L1, which are listed in front on page listing L1. So Since this is second reading, unless anybody wants to pull any of these out for further discussion, I propose that we motion to approve all of them.
I'll make the motion.
Board Member Servio?
Support.
Board Member Thatcher, is any discussion on L1? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Now we're on the first readings on L2, which again were highlighted for ease of access and reading and understanding. Is there a motion to approve L2?
I make a motion to approve the first reading of policy number 1431, considered staffing layoff and recall of administrators.
Is there a support? Is there a support?
I'll support that.
We have a motion and support. Any discussion on the motion?
Yeah, these are subjective things. You know, you're talking about laying off people or letting people go. These are subjective, individual performance. You have people that are actually doing these evaluations, doing the layoffs. So this is very subjective. I think this sets us up for a little bit of trouble because arbitrary and capricious is all over this. This isn't something that's been recommended by NEOLA and it's time to change in law. So why are we doing it?
Is there a specific
when we have a reason to let go of an administrator is based on significant relevant accomplishments and contributions, what does that mean? That doesn't mean anything. What is a relevant accomplishment or contribution? Does that mean they sweep the floor?
We've attempted to do a few things here. One is to try to make the language as similar as possible to our professional staff. Another thing was to get into the recent changes in the laws and use that language, which no longer has seniority, but does list effectiveness of the employee, as well as the other areas that you pointed out, those three other areas.
So what does NEOLA suggest? Because these are not things that I think that we can actually say. We can't stand in court and say, oh yeah, Judge, I didn't think they had enough relevant accomplishments. That's why I let this person go. We're going to get creamed on this stuff. I mean, this is another one of those things that's common sense. Relevant special training, relevant to what? So if they have special training in special ed, we keep them. But if they don't have training in special ed, we don't keep them. These are things that you're having the person that's making these decisions, which are completely arbitrary. Individual performance, significant relevant accomplishments and contributions, and relevant special training. You're asking for so much subjectivity here that opens us up to big trouble. And I don't understand why we have administration here writing these policies when we hire NEOLA to do this. Why are we not using what NEOLA says?
Have you had legal review of this?
Yes.
Okay,
who reviewed it?
We had an attorney review it.
We didn't have
those for us to look at because I have to agree with Mrs. Sullivan. This is, we need to look at this.
And just to clarify, this was written by the district attorney. It was actually not even just looked at.
But we hired NEOLA for this.
Yeah, and for reasons that, well, for whatever reasons, they did not have this part of the work policy for either the professional staff or the administrators. And it's an area that needs to be addressed, and our attorney wrote this, and...
this is not the policy. When you're saying that all personnel decisions will be made based on the following factors, A, individual performance, what does that mean? Does that mean you're going to look at their evaluations? Does that mean, you know, you decide when you don't work in the building with someone? Does that mean you're going to have a random survey of 8 teachers? Hey, what do you think about this person? This is not good policy. So I'd like to see, if you had a lawyer actually write this, I'd like to see the back and forth, the paperwork that we paid for someone to give us this. And I would also like to see what NEOLA suggests, because this is not good policy. I've been on the policy committee for many, many years. This is not good policy. Significant relevant accomplishments and contributions. Who decides that?
I don't decide that.
They're making open-ended and...
Relevant special training.
Individual performance. What one administrator does in a school compared to another level is compared, a high school compared to an elementary is generally different in their basis. And I agree. I got a feeling it's open-ended and would be difficult to...
There's no way we can support this.
Support it.
And that is part of the reason why it's so important to have good tools that we have. We talked a lot about that.
But you're not citing the tools that you're using. You're just saying individual performance. And this policy needs to be good policy for every board that sits here going forward for the next 20 years. It can't be vague and allow the ins and outs where, you know, someone who's worked here for years and can lose their job because some person decides their individual performance isn't whatever they think it should be when there's no definition. This is not good policy.
I think there should be sub-bullets describing what
individual
performance is.
This needs to be done by Neola. We hire them for that. We pay them for that. They write policy that can be backed up by law. I don't understand why, again, we didn't do what we're paying somebody to do. I mean, that's like saying, here, babysitter, I'm going to give you $20 for the night, but I'm taking the baby with me. This isn't even the common sense again.
We had a full discussion on the side. We have a motion.
When did we have a full discussion?
We have a motion and a second. Fair amount of discussion on this.
I do think that we need to take this back.
You made the original motion, and so would you amend that motion to ask for further background on support? I think the fair amount of discussion has been on demonstrating definitions and expectations of performance, so the process is clear to all three. I've heard that, and so the second, Mr. Hoover, you made a second, would you ask that we put this in advance until further explanation to bring back the board for the first reading? And please, so the ayes have it. The first reading is not even if we approve this first reading tonight, that would not enact that policy change. It takes several readings, and sometimes in between those steps, we can get clarification. At this point, we've actually backed off further than that, but we're not even doing the first reading and asking for further clarification. So we've had to withdraw that, and hearing no other discussion, we'll have the staff,
I'm going to amend my motion
that
we take this policy back to administration and get further clarification and further in-depth discussion on the second ABC of this.
I would ask whether that's necessary to put that in form of a motion. I think that we would instruct the staff to bring it back, so taking no action.
I put a motion on the floor initially, and I'm amending that initial motion.
Okay,
so
please.
I would like it to go for a vote.
Well, okay, then please state the motion again so we can,
I made the motion originally to approve this, and it was supported.
Right.
Now I'm amending my motion to say that I would like it to go back for consideration and more in-depth discussion along with changing of the language, going back to either our attorney or Neola, looking at the law, just look at this total policy as a rewrite.
I guess if do the best you can to that motion and writing and anything we need to do.
So the only thing you're doing then is rescinding your motion to approve it, right?
No.
Basically. Okay. And sending it back to administration.
Well, I think administration has to do that when you rescind the motion.
I'm sorry, you put a motion on the table, my understanding is.
Well, she should, she's our.
I'm sorry, excuse me. You put a motion on the table, correct?
Yes.
Okay, is there a second on that motion?
Or support that, and I will change my support to.
Okay. We have a motion and a second, and I take it that all everybody kind of got the intent of the reading of that, and I know that the secretary is feverishly writing. Any further discussion on the amended motion?
Yeah, I have one. Mrs. Johnson, can you please provide us the correspondence with the attorneys that led to this? I'm just curious which attorney came up with this.
Okay, that was one of my requests, so you might not want to write it down. And I'd also like to see what recommendation Neola has for this policy. Because I'm confused as to why, if Neola has a policy that defines this, that they back up, because they back all of their policies up, that we went out and hired an attorney to come up with something different that seems very not good. So I would like the Neola policy, and I would like the documentation from the attorneys who wrote this.
We have a motion in front of us with a second. Is there any discussion on that motion?
What's the motion specifically? Was it to rescind the motion?
Secretary Ross, I don't know if you have the opportunity to put it in writing or would you?
I amended my first motion, and the amendment is to not approve it, it is to send it back to administration for a rewrite.
We need to move on now?
Yeah.
Okay, there was a motion and a second, and a much shorter version, I think, is what we could act on.
Send it back, give us the opinion, check the Neola, rewrite, come back and talk to us.
Okay. All in favor?
That all doesn't make the motion.
Sorry.
We'll address the tape if you need to get the money. All right, I think that we got the gist. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. On to the next item. So again, it's highlighted. This is the weapons policy update. Is there a motion to approve L3 for the board to adopt the first reading of policy provisions and additions listed in L3? Is there a motion? That's one more time. Is there a motion to approve the first reading of policy update L3? Hearing none, we're not acting on that.
Can I make a comment about this?
I'm sorry, that's not we're done. We're on with the next item.
They don't want to talk about
that, the discussions, I don't know. On to the unfinished business. The board, and I do appreciate the district received response from all board members on the board self-evaluation. There was a fair amount of discussion on the process for proceeding with that. The options had been discussed previously, and there was some discussion to have a facilitated discussion versus having me present having the board president do the presentation of the results. I think that we've had a conversation a couple times on this matter. If there's any question, I'd like to have the superintendent coordinate a date with all board members to bring us together to have a facilitated discussion on the board self-evaluation and the results of that. So that will be forthcoming.
What would be the cost of a facilitated discussion?
I think that it was communicated before, that's about $750 plus expenses.
Okay, given that you've already spent almost $40,000 trying to get people to be quiet, do you think that's a good plan to spend more money?
I don't know that you have to work well together. I understand that's your opinion.
Money.
You have strong opinions. I understand.
Well, we could be spending $750 for, say, a 2-hour discussion.
Great.
That's a lot of money.
Okay. So, unless I can present the information, and I again for some discussion from board members that have requested that we do have a facilitated meeting.
Is the data been compiled as a not individual, but as a group, the findings and the score?
Yes.
And when can we have that?
Can the board members have the compiled data before we discuss about whether we're going to have
So data on that?
I haven't received the data. I like resolution on this because to pick and choose personalities on a self-evaluation. I haven't seen the results yet. I don't know how it reflects.
Not each individual member.
Right.
Compiled data.
Yeah, I would be happy to give you the feedback from MASB when we were talking in MASB about the options available in this. They said that if we were going to facilitate a discussion, they preferred that the results are presented by them that evening because their history or experience has been that results in a better discussion. So they have concerns about having a facilitated discussion where the information is provided.
But that's not their decision to make.
That is true.
So he's asking for it ahead of time. It seems like a reasonable request.
Well, we have strong personalities on this board, and I would suggest that if we want to take advantage of a self-evaluation process, that no one board member or nobody makes personal decisions in that, and that actually somebody from outside of our district with experience in this present the information without us being having preconceptions of what they are. I personally am in strong support of it. That takes me out of the presentation mode as the chair of the board. I would prefer it to be handled by somebody with a professional background and experience in presenting the information.
So far we have your opinion. Stan, we have the
from the board members we've all talked about.
And you would like the information before us.
Excuse me.
I don't understand what the problem is about why if we all filled out. It said right on there you could call a number and request a copy. I don't understand why we can't have a copy of the completed evaluation prior to sitting down with someone from MASB.
Any other opinions?
Why is that
problem? I think that a facilitator is really every money well spent. I appreciate their comment that they prefer that the results be held until the evening or the day, whatever, of the facilitated discussion. I appreciate that. I personally don't have a problem with receiving it ahead of time and reviewing it for myself, but I really am ambivalent about that particular issue, but I do think that facilitated discussion is extremely incumbent on this board to really do the work of bothering to do a board self-evaluation effectively.
I'm all for the facilitator, but to me, we won't be able to ask questions, good questions. If I see the data and I'll say, all right, how can we fix this? I won't be able to ask this kind of question because it's going to be like all new. And I have to process things.
I'll go back to my concern. We have a strongly opinionated board that I think if we're all introduced with the same information at the same time, believe it or not, our board throws on the attack sometimes and is very aggressive. And where we're all starting at the same place, maybe an opportunity for us to come to consensus for preparing arguments and attacks ahead of time. That's my feeling. I feel pretty strongly about it. If we're going to do an evaluation, let's have one that somebody else that knows more than us comes in and helps us do this better, because this is so dysfunctional sometimes, it's insulting to the board and not the community.
Well, if a question was rated about how we're doing something and it says 80% of the board members feel that we're mediocre or less, that just helps me ask the question, what can we do to fix it?
That's why you need a facilitator. So having been through board self-evaluations as president for the past 2 years, when the information was brought to this board, there was absolutely no decent conversation about our evaluation. It was personal attacks, and we got nowhere. So hopefully, with a facilitator, we might be able to control our emotions, and we might be able to have a solid discussion on how we can better ourselves as a board. And maybe that person can just give us some ideas on how to do it.
All right,
it would be a workshop.
This would be a workshop.
Mr. Hubbard is always asked from this
board. Is this a Hooper, by the way?
Yeah, so I'm just looking for consensus.
Now, you're interrupting me, okay? So you're always asking this board to come prepared and that you want to withhold information to make people less prepared.
If board members came prepared, we wouldn't have to have that discussion.
If board members were responding to.
And I understand your point, you know, you're trying to get banned. And I think this is one of those cases where preconceptions could be problematic on any resolution. So, thank you. I'm looking for consensus, I'm looking for non-town facilitator or not, okay? I'm looking for not, this isn't a vote, but yeah, okay. In general, consensus is that we will find a facilitator. We'll be contacted for dates. And let's let the facilitator do their job. Thank you.
Mr. Cooper, just real quick, we did something similar a few years ago. And while I appreciate that, you know, your point is well taken. You do want to have a little bit of lead time to look some stuff over, you have a little bit of some questions, and that makes sense. But didn't we kind of do that once before? We had a little bit of time to review some stuff, and then we did have discussion time too. I mean, let's be real, we're not going to just let someone come in and go, so you, and blah, 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 blah. We're going to have a serious discussion, and we're going to ask questions, we're going to ask hard questions, we're going to look for some serious input from a professional to help us do what we do better. So yeah, we should have some time to review it. We should have some time for discussion and questions. And that is just all kind of part of that whole process. And I mean, I don't think that we've ever had someone who's supposed to come in and help you wouldn't sit there and entertain the questions and comments that we would have over the course of them doing their job.
What we've been doing hasn't been working very well, so that's up for
you. So a little confused by just Sharon's question. Is it going to be a compiled of the data, no individual, one evaluation is, you know, like this evaluation said this, this, and this, but all the compiled. Question number one, this is the percentage that agree, get very good to very poor, and these are the percentages down the line.
All right.
If you go on the NASB website, you can see how you report it out. It reports out in a horizontal way. You can see. So of seven, it would be two said very good, three said satisfactory, two said not good, or whatever.
Disagree.
Whatever the ranking.
Disagree.
We do need objectivity from a professional working look at the data. They don't know the details behind it. They have seven, but they'll see the issue. And so it's not as good we have objectivity.
Well, I'm not the objectivity. It's just that having the raw data, having the compiled data, just.
I have one other unfinished business about, we had a speaker come, Mrs. Little came to our last meeting and spoke, and she had a complete statement prepared, and I'm wondering if anyone else got a copy of that statement to answer any questions. Because
she distributed?
No, but I requested it. And she had many questions, and she had some other things that she pointed out during her time at the podium about why was data given to the building utilization in their binder, which I now have, different, and this is the elementary building utilization data, than the data that was presented to the school board at our board workshop in December. So what I have in front of me are basically the same documents, and yet for several of our schools, we, the board, was given different capacity numbers than the Building Utilization Committee. And for the life of me, reading through these several times, I cannot figure out why. And it's to the point that at our board workshop, we were told building capacity on the same document was 672, yet building utilization was told it was 700 for that one. For Carpenter, they were told it was 700, and we were told it was 644. So when you take a look at all these numbers that are different for all of our elementary schools, but the curious thing is, nothing was changed for any of our middle schools. All of the numbers for capacity are the same. But all of our elementary school numbers, except for one, are different. So when you go through and you do the percentages for utilization for everything else, it gives the board a completely different view than it gave the building utilization committee. And I'm wondering why, when you're presenting numbers, numbers are numbers. They don't change. Building capacity does not change. So why was the board given different information than the building utilization committee was given?
So we first, when we first gave out the binder for building utilization, that was based on some preliminary numbers. As we got deeper into the discussion, we actually walked the buildings and can find some things, like as you were talking about differences in numbers, you can see, you know, it's 28, that's a classroom. And so we might have, in our preliminary numbers, saw a room and thought that it was at least 900 square foot feet appropriate for a classroom. And then as we went through it, we found areas where the numbers looked different. We did actually provide updates on what you have there.
Is the building utilization numbers. It has capacity numbers on it. These capacity numbers are the same as the capacity numbers on this spreadsheet, which are different from the spreadsheet that was given to the board.
That's right.
And it's not just like 28 kids. One is 56, one is 28, one is 84 kids, another is 84 kids, where the board is being told that a building has a capacity plus 80, less, minus.